Of all our solar system's planets, few have provided a greater testing ground for competing scientific hypotheses than Venus. Prior to the arrival of the Soviet Venera and Mariner spacecrafts at Venus in 1960, many astronomers proposed that Venus would be covered with oceans and perhaps lush vegetation. After all, Earth and Venus are a very similar size and distance from the Sun. So in the standard theory of our solar system's origins and history, which proposes that planets accreted in a solar nebular cloud about 4 billion years ago, astronomers saw every basis to characterize Venus as Earth's twin. However, one controversial figure made an outrageously unconventional prediction about Venus. Immanuel Velikovsky, author of the best-selling 1950 book Worlds in Collision, proposed that Venus entered the inner solar system recently as a cometary body, appearing as a terrifying specter in the earthly sky just a few thousand years ago, during an epoch of planetary instability. Thus, Velikovsky predicted that space probes would find a hellish landscape on Venus, with extraordinarily hot, nearly incandescent surface temperatures. Of course, on this prediction, as well as many others, Velikovsky was proven correct. Nevertheless, institutionalized science dismissed these successes, thus preserving the standard story of our solar system's history, not to mention the dominance of gravity-centric cosmology. As I'll explain in a moment, the Velikovsky affair, including the Venus controversy, played an important role in scientists' ideas about so-called global warming on planet Earth, with Venus supposedly providing a model of our own planet's potential future. However, a recent scientific study on Venus's atmosphere suggests that it was never home to vast oceans, and was never habitable. A Science Alert report describes the findings as follows. Venus's reputation as a cautionary tale of an Earth gone bad may have been somewhat exaggerated. We've thought that before it became the toxic hellscape we know today, Venus could have once been habitable, with oceans of liquid water shimmering on its surface. New research reveals that Earth's so-called sister planet may never have had liquid oceans, because it was not able to, even when water was available. In fact, an analysis of the planet's atmosphere suggests that it has always been drier than a bone, inside and out. Astronomer Teresa Constantino is quoted as saying, "By calculating the present rate of atmospheric destruction of water, carbon dioxide, and carbonyl sulfide, which must be restored by volcanism to maintain atmospheric stability, we show that Venus's interior is dry. The dry interior is consistent with Venus ending its magma ocean epoch desiccated and thereafter having had a long-lived dry surface. Volcanic resupply to Venus's atmosphere, therefore, indicates that the planet has never been liquid water habitable." Now, of course, this scientific analysis in no way contradicts the theory of Venus's cometary origins. I think it's worthwhile now to offer a brief yet comprehensive review of the Venus controversy and its ramifications for our understanding of the solar system and of our own planet. Well, over half a century has passed since the Soviet Union probe Venera 4 became the first spacecraft to touch down on Venus's surface. Since then, the planet has offered nothing but surprises to investigating scientists. As the astronomer Victor A. Firsoff wrote in his book The Solar Planets, it would be hard to find a more improbable planet than Venus. From its extraordinary high temperatures, to its networks of filamentary scars running across its surface, its mysteriously shiny mountains at its highest altitudes, occasional superbolts of lightning, superfast upper atmospheric winds, its enormous comet-like plasma tail, and the twin vortices at its north and south poles. As mentioned, one of the biggest surprises early in the space age was the discovery of Venus's super-hot temperatures. Prior to the discovery, many scientists, including Fred Whipple, the originator of the dirty snowball model of comets, had proposed that the surface of Venus might be mostly or entirely covered by oceans. The consensus theory today among planetary scientists is that Venus's dense, mostly carbon dioxide atmosphere has caused heating through a greenhouse effect. However, as the aforementioned Victor Firsoff noted, Earth's seas are not boiling hot, despite the total greenhouse effect of water and the average sunlight stronger than at the ground level of Venus. Nor is it at all clear how such a condition could have become established. The late physicist Wal Thornhill addressed the issue in a 2003 article. He stated, "Venus receives 1.9 times more solar radiation than Earth, but its clouds reflect about 80% of that sunlight, so that Venus actually absorbs less solar energy than the Earth. Even with the maximum greenhouse effect, the effective surface temperature of Venus should be low enough to freeze water. What is being asked of the so-called runaway greenhouse effect is equivalent to expecting a well-insulated oven to reach a temperature sufficient to melt lead by having only the pilot light switched on. In recent years, some scientists have recognized that extreme events are required to explain Venus's extraordinary temperatures. One study nearly a decade ago proposed that a spherical object between 500 and 1,000 miles wide struck Venus, melting its upper mantle and triggering the so-called runaway greenhouse effect. However, like countless other mysteries of Venus, its extremely high temperatures may be the result of extraordinary events that planetary scientists have never considered. In Worlds in Collision, Velikovsky proposed that the planet Venus was a comet that passed close enough to Earth to violently perturb its axis, decimating early civilizations. By studying the historical accounts of far-flung cultures, Velikovsky constructed a thesis of celestial catastrophe. The converging ancient images include the Babylonian torch star Venus, and the bearded star Venus, the Mexican smoking star Venus, the Peruvian long-haired star Venus, the Egyptian great star scattering its flame and fire, and the widespread imagery of Venus as a flaming serpent or dragon in the sky. In each instance, the cometary language is undeniable, for these were the very symbols of the comet in the ancient languages. In following the evidence, Velikovsky discovered that Venus holds a special place in the world's first astronomies, in both the Old World and the New. Ancient stargazers regarded Venus with awe and terror, carefully observing its risings and settings, and claiming the planet to be the cause of world-ending catastrophe. Velikovsky reasoned that these astronomical traditions must have had roots in a traumatic human experience, though consensus science has always assured us that the planets evolved in quiet and undisturbed isolation over billions of years. Based on extensive cross-cultural comparison, Velikovsky concluded that the planet Venus, prior to the dawn of recorded history, was ejected violently from the gas giant Jupiter, displaying a spectacular comet-like tail. Its later catastrophic approach to Earth around 1500 BC provided the historical backdrop to the Hebrew Exodus. Velikovsky argued that the terrifying gods of the ancient world were planets. Worlds in Collision recounted two close encounters of the comet or protoplanet Venus with Earth. The founder of the Thunderbolts project, David Talbott, was originally inspired by Velikovsky's research and began his own reconstruction of these ancient catastrophes based on a comparison of converging cultural traditions from around the world. Talbott never claimed to know when Venus was born, but instead focused on Venus's role in a primordial alignment of planets close to Earth in an earlier time, just prior to the birth of the great civilizations. The planet Saturn hung as a massive sphere in the sky. Seen visually in its center was a radiant star surrounded by explosive streamers. Cultures the world over claim to see Venus in feminine terms as the mother goddess. In the Thunderbolts documentary Symbols of an Alien Sky, Talbott discusses in detail the complex role of Venus in ancient myths as the quote, great star, the mother of all stars, the central eye, heart, and soul of the primeval sun god Saturn, the quote, hub and spokes of the wheel of heaven, and much more. What would one expect of a planet that was recently the focus of an intense cometary electrical discharge? From our perspective, the answer is exactly what we see with Venus. Consider this 2013 Space.com report, which states, "Planet Venus sometimes looks less like a planet and more like a comet." This statement describes the changes scientists have witnessed in Venus's ionosphere, much like a comet in response to the solar wind. Indeed, one of the earliest space-age surprises about Venus was the discovery of its so-called cometary magnetotail in the form of, quote, stringy things, or plasma current filaments stretching as far as Earth's orbit. In the electric universe, any body in our solar system on a sufficiently eccentric orbit about the Sun can display comet-like characteristics due to its movement radially through the Sun's electric field. Venus is at the focus of an electrical discharge. The electrical phenomena witnessed today on the planet can be understood as a smaller scale version of the very activity witnessed by mankind in prehistory. The twin vortices at Venus's poles are the focal points of Birkeland currents from the Sun, which drive the planet's super-rotating upper atmosphere. As we've reported many times, solar storms have been found to create increased lightning on Earth. And it is electric currents from the sun that also drive the extraordinary Venusian lightning. Venus has a more direct electrical connection with the sun than Earth, which mainstream astronomy describes as so-called magnetic flux ropes. But as we've so often pointed out, magnetic fields in space are conducted by electric currents flowing through space plasma. Although Venus has no water clouds that are thought necessary to generate lightning, there is evidence that lightning on the planet is far more intense than on Earth, with extreme lightning called superbolts that strike from the Venusian ionosphere directly to the ground. On Earth, water clouds prevent such powerful discharges by spreading the charge from above, transferred there by ionospheric sprites. The superfast winds of Venus are also difficult to explain by conventional meteorology. Cloud movements show a 4-day rotation period of the upper atmosphere at the equator, which declines to 2 days toward the poles. Within the framework of standard theory, no force is present to drive the upper winds around the planet at such a speed, since Venus itself has a rotational period of 243 days retrograde, and the planet's lower winds are exceptionally sluggish. Since the planet is the same temperature overall, there is no temperature gradient to drive these winds either. In recent years, it has been reported that the superfast winds of Venus have actually been steadily accelerating. Even more mysterious, while the winds were accelerating, scientists have also discovered that the planet's rotation has been mysteriously slowing down. In the electric universe theory, as Wall Thornhill developed, the deposition or extraction of charge from an object will change its mass, and therefore its rotation rate, which has been observed on Earth in small changes of the Earth's rotation, when we receive a large blast of charged particles from the sun. Glitches in Mars's rotation have also been found in association with its mysterious global dust storms. On Venus, then, both the accelerating winds and the planet's slowing rotation could be due to a variation in the incoming electrical current flow. Most telling of all are the filamentary, so-called Lichtenberg networks seen stretching for thousands of miles across Venus's surface. With electrical discharges occurring in high-pressure gases, the result is the kind of filamentary patterns so clearly present on Venus. All this is to say that the principles brought to light by the electric universe paradigm may help to illuminate an extraordinary new picture of Venus, its place within our solar system today, and its remarkable impact on human history.